preparing me. Yeah, yeah.
Right, let's start the first track of the morning session. The large scale modeling and the first presentation, the multi-scale simulation modeling for prevention and public health management of diabetes in pregnancy and sickle life. I just realized.
Thanks so much, Pedram, and it's a great pleasure and honor to be with you today to share with you a brief glimpse of our work using multi-scale hybrid modeling for examining at scale the problem of designing intervention portfolios for preventing and managing a very urgent public health risk associated with diabetes in pregnancy and its impacts on type 2 diabetes. Because of the abbreviated time for this talk, I'm only going to be able to really provide a glimpse of this model. I will note that this model also enjoys a separate publication in PLOS One, which is just days ago come out, which focuses on the modeling process. And if people are interested in learning more about the modeling project more generally, that's a good reference. But I'd like to situate and motivate this work. The work is motivated by a marked rise in diabetes and pregnancy that occurred in the Australian Capital Territories, the ACT, over the past 20 years. And this rise is a reflection in part of a growing level of set of risk factors within that population, but is reflective of a rise worldwide that we see across many industrial countries, and indeed many countries in the developing world, associated with diabetes and pregnancy, and subsequently type 2 diabetes. This, for example, from our backyard in Saskatchewan, Canada, where we've conducted multi-generational and multi-decadal studies of diabetes and pregnancy and found markedly high rates and rates that exert much more burden on vulnerable groups, particularly our First Nations population. Now, taken in and of itself, in earlier times, diabetes and pregnancy was viewed as a bit of a nuisance, an inconvenience, but a transient phenomenon that would go away. These days, it's the point of a tremendous amount of concern, in part because of the contributions we and other investigators have made from more of a systems lens. And the concerns here relate to two types of impact, two spheres of impact. One on the mother. Gestational diabetes is associated with, and I use that term here in a statistical sense, with approximately a 9 times greater likelihood of subsequent gestational diabetes. So if you have one bout, you're very likely to have another bout for a subsequent pregnancy. Second of all, for the mother, it's associated with a dramatically elevated risk of type 2 diabetes, okay, in later life. And for reasons we'll go into about some of the mechanisms later, these include a large causal component. The mechanisms are increasingly well understood. For offspring, there's also a tremendous risk. And specifically, it manifests in the short term in terms of macrosomia, so babies that are large for gestational age, birth complications, risk of shoulder dystocia during birth, NICU admissions, need for cesarean sections, and metabolic syndrome, obesity, and high risks of type 2 diabetes later in life, and indeed of gestational diabetes, and the vicious cycle continues. These results are also well evidenced as having causal components. And in some studies done onto 15 or 20 years ago now, amongst certain Native American groups, dose-response relationships were demonstrated, which showed the higher level of dysglycemia in pregnancy, the higher risk to that offspring to develop later type 2 diabetes. If they were exposed in utero, in other words, to diabetes, they're much, much, much more likely to develop diabetes themselves. And The effects on discordant siblings are, again, strongly suggestive of causal relationship. If there's one sibling who's born to a mother before she gets diabetes, another after, that born after has much, much higher risk of obesity, for example. So the overall aim here, in light of this gnarly relationship between gestational diabetes and for the mother and her risk of type 2 diabetes and later GDM, and the impact on the next generation, the goal for our sponsors was they sought to develop a dynamic simulation model to inform a portfolio of very diverse interventions, and diversity is key here, for prevention and management of diabetes and pregnancy in the Australian Capital Territories, a region with mid-hundred thousands population, and to test a set of interventions that were varied in their scope and level of application. This work involved a huge amount of participatory modeling work, which lies outside the scope of this presentation, except to note many, many consultative sessions, a large group advising us as modelers, and many meetings with diverse experts in different parts of the system. The model that was built ended up being distinguished by several features. At a technical level, it's a hybrid model. It weaves together under a single roof three typically separately pursued types of systems modeling traditions: system dynamics modeling, stock and flows, unpacking to ODEs at a mathematical level, ordinary differential equations, agent-based modeling, and discrete event simulation. And each of these plays a key role in different faces of the model, but they all interact as the model runs to understand the impacts of interventions and to do projections and development of the current situation. System dynamics model predominantly used for physiology, agent-based model capturing that physiology but relating it to broader context, familial context, aspects of heterogeneity, age, gender, ethnicity, etc., and a variety of clinical related things like diagnosis, status, etc., and discrete simulation where the agents flow through it. So why do we use a hybrid model? Why a hybrid model? Some have suggested that they're nice playthings, but beyond intellectual curiosity, they don't bring much to the table. After building quite a large number in practical use for solving real-world problems, I happen to disagree. Hybrid models have their place. In this case, it was motivated by a variety of desiderata. One was the desire to investigate, as I had noted, this diversity of different interventions in the intervention portfolio. Our stakeholders were very interested in understanding clinical level interventions and phenomena at the clinical level, including prescription of things like insulin for mothers during diabetes and pregnancy, something that hasn't traditionally been done in many jurisdictions, enhancing adherence and lifestyle change during pregnancy when a mother is especially invested in her health. But it also involved interest in understanding the impacts of different clinical care pathways, understanding the impacts of changes in how we handle women at risk early on in their pregnancy and as pregnancy develops and risk signs develop. And finally, public health interventions focused on the population as a whole or certain groups known to be at higher risk. Now, the need to capture this varied impact of interventions extended across these levels and also involved aspects of adherence history. The same intervention, one of the insights that came from our clinical partners is the same intervention undertaken early, stitch in time saves nine, and undertaken very early in a woman's trajectory, maybe in her first pregnancy as she's showing risk factors, may make a world of difference in the gains. That same woman, same intervention, two pregnancies later, after two bouts of earlier gestational diabetes, very little impact. And why? Because there's aspects of state, in particular aspects of beta cell mass and function, that are lost over time because of the early incidence of gestational diabetes that puts her in a state where her body can't respond effectively to take advantage of that intervention. Even if she works really hard, she's you know, pushing that rock uphill like Sisyphus. Another motivation was the desire to capture context and heterogeneity, aspects of family structure. This is all about moms and babies, and to be able to capture that family structure was very important, related to historical information, et cetera. And we wanted to be able to accumulate history on a particular agent and use it to calibrate against data. For the discrete event simulation side, we needed to investigate health service delivery workflows, which were quite articulated, and where resourcing levels might be varied and where we needed to track times and throughputs, and it seemed natural to make use of a well-posed discrete event simulation component. So the model division that shook out here, and I'm going to have to go quickly here, system dynamics model captured broadly physiology. This included interaction of insulin, glycemia, and beta cell mass and function, which was evolving over a woman's life course. This is a life course model. This was based on a set of models that came out of Joe Gaetano's work, particularly, and which proposed a set of well-calibrated ODE models of the evolution of diabetes with any given person and the development of diabetes from pre-diabetic state and progressed it out and compared to clinical trials. So it drew on upper dozens of papers. Insulin sensitivity within this model has its own endogenous progression, but it's also inflected by factors from the ABM, weight dynamics, and pregnancy. The agent-based model characterized a variety of factors, aspects of heterogeneity, age, gender, ethnicity, and the length of a baby to its mother, but it also characterized certain features within state charts. State charts characterizing the current state of a woman and the possible evolution over time, including those associated with pregnancy and breastfeeding, affecting differential fertility and age-specific fertility. Classifications of clinical labeling of a person whose dynamics is driven by the physiology, but then interprets it at a clinical level. And similarly, diagnosis status, whether they're recognized as, say, being a type 2 diabetic by the medical system, so is it known they have type 2 diabetes from the sake of the care pathways? That's going to relate, obviously, to testing. So the outcomes for the baby were influenced those for the mother, so following in utero exposure, a baby's experience in utero and the mother's level of glycemic control affected the birth weight, the type of birth, and risks of outcomes such as neonatal intensive care unit and shoulder injury in an evidence-based fashion. We also had a quite articulated system for weight dynamics, which captures weight dynamics over multiple decades now, very carefully, and it's based on Z-scores and patterns of evolution over time in the weight population. The discrete event model within this context, part of it is shown here. This is, I believe, the default pathway, and fundamentally these were clinical care pathways, both as they exist now and in their alternatives as being evaluated by the region, for how they would impact health, cost, and flow. So the model was calibrated against a wide variety of data, and that included incidence data, macrosomia data from the ACT. It also included longitudinal data from other jurisdictions, particularly from our multi-generational study of diabetes and pregnancy in Canada. Beyond this, there's dozens, maybe somewhere up above 100 different papers we drew on for evidence associated with model parameters that didn't have to be calibrated, but were rather estimated and placed into the model directly. Simulation model outputs can be compared against a number of metrics. Broadly, the stakeholders are very happy with how it matched things, especially given redefinitions of standards and measurement methodologies. It is a stochastic model, and so it requires Monte Carlo ensembles to run for comparisons. We investigated a variety of interventions from the clinical level, health services level, and population level. And what's notable here, and I have to finish up almost immediately, is we can interpret these interventions as they affect a particular woman's trajectory. For example, looking at her BMI and insulin sensitivity as we intervene following, this is occurrence of GDM. If we didn't intervene and we see insulin sensitivity stays low, if we do intervene and we bring down BMI, her insulin sensitivity rebounds following pregnancy, both because the impact of pregnancy is passed on suppressing insulin sensitivity and because of the effects of the intervention in terms of lowering weight. So we ran, we can interpret things at an individual level, but we can also interpret things at the level of physiological outcomes, beta cell mass and function, insulin sensitivity, glycemic levels across the population. We can do so at the population level, we can do so at the individual level. Often doing so at the population level gives you an understanding of the mediating factors that mediate the outcomes in broad terms that you see in terms of occurrence of death. So conclusions, to capture the needs in a diverse portfolio of interventions here, we introduced a hybrid multi-scale modeling. This model architecture very flexibly and performantly, we're simulating hundreds of thousands of agents across the population, the full population of the ACT, characterizing changes in effects of intervention, physiological evolution of an individual, effects of pregnancy, aging, BMI change. And this capacity to characterize things both beneath the skin and behavior and contextual factors above the skin bodes well, I think, for many conditions where interventions are mediated in fundamental ways by physiologic response, but where there's a fundamental shaping of context and of decision making vis-a-vis adherence, opting into different clinical pathways, et cetera, that play well. We're very pleased with the model architecture and outcomes and are working to elaborate it for childhood dynamics, which was a shortcoming of that model, not really capturing dynamics in childhood well. But better capturing social networks and better representation of behavior change, so important to this conference. So that's all I have time to mention here, but I want to thank the audience, the organizers, and I want to thank the many sponsors who helped make this work possible and continue to enable its evolution. Thank you very much.
Do we have time to take two questions, maybe?